Well, good afternoon. I'm Richard Haass, and I want to welcome all of you to the Council on Foreign Relations and to today's CEO Speaker Series meeting. This is part of the Council on Foreign Relations corporate program, which is supposed to increase the connections and links between the business community and the foreign policy community, which to some extent are one and the same. I also want to thank, rather welcome CFR members, not simply those of you in the room, but those around the country and the world who are participating in this meeting through to the wonders of modern technology. Speaking of modern technology, if people would just take a second to turn off their cell phones and the like, that would be most welcome. This meeting is on the record. As we say, anything you say, sir, can and will, I'm sure, be used against you. In this day and age, probably some things you haven't said will be used against you.
There's no such thing as privileged and confidential anymore.
No. The phrase, someone needs no introduction, is often used. It's a hackneyed. In this case, it actually applies. Jamie Dimon is not simply the head of one of the principal financial institutions in this country, JPMorgan Chase, but I believe has emerged as one of the most important and influential spokesman for the worlds of finance and business in the United States. The way it's going to work today is he and I are going to have this conversation for a few minutes, and then we will open it up to you all for your questions. Let me just get one or two conflicts of interest on the table and out of the way. I should say that J.P. Morgan Chase is a corporate member of the Council on Foreign Relations, one of around 175 corporate members. And I am a shareholder in the company. Unfortunately, I am a distinct minority shareholder. And I wish it were enough to present a conflict of interest, but alas, it's not. But there you go. Mr. Dimon, as I expect many of you may know, is of Greek heritage. And so let's, in the last 24 hours, the Chancellor of Germany has been visiting the country of your ancestors, of your forebears. How worried are you about the prospects for Greece and what it might mean, not just for Greece and not just for Europe, but because of globalization and economic linkages for the United States and indirectly for your own institution?
Right. So thank you for the introduction. And my ancestors left Greece like 1915, so you can't blame me for what's going on there. But as a side note, I remember my grandfather coming home years ago and Greeks on both sides yelling and screaming about the then prime minister, who was the grandfather of the guy who was the prime minister a little bit while back, arguing almost the same points. Communism, socialism, capitalism, same basic argument, and you know who won. So Greece, you know, the issue, obviously, we all want Greece to succeed and survive, but from an economic standpoint, Greece is not the issue. You know, Greece is a couple hundred billion dollars of debt. A default to Greece or exit of Greece on its own isn't the catastrophe. The catastrophe is that if you have a default of Greece, before you have a firewall for Italy and Spain, you have a very good likelihood you're going to have a run in the banks in Italy and Spain. Italy and Spain don't have the wherewithal to stop the run in the banks. They need the money. They can't print euro. They don't have they have things called central banks, but they can't print euro, which puts them in a very difficult position. And that's why what you're reading about is that you need a banking union and an FDIC deposit scheme. $700 billion has already left Italy and Spain. Most of it went to Germany. The German banks deposited at the Bundesbank, and the Bundesbank, by law, under a thing called Target 2, had to lend it back to the Italian and Spanish central banks. So the problem's already been widely socialized inside Europe, counter to what most people think. So so to solve Europe, you need three things. You need to stop a banking crisis in Italy and Spain. You need a real fiscal union. They have one that doesn't work. You know, a lot of people years ago said it wouldn't work, but it was really a minority. And they've got to do it soon because it's bleeding slowly. I do want to remind people, it's really important, were really good reasons for the union. One was political. You know, this is a continent that for hundreds, thousands of years had multiple wars. Hundreds of millions of people died. So you could really say that's a good objective. Let's have a political union that maybe we don't kill each other. The second was an economic union, the common market. And they would look at the United States and say, you know, if we had a common market, i.e. same railroads, same regulation, the same rules, regulation, stuff like that, that it would be a huge boost to the economies of Europe. Those two reasons still exist. So I personally think they're still going to muddle through because the alternative to muddling through is potentially so bad, and I think the policymakers know that. Now, I could be wrong, but that's, I still think, but it'll be a roller coaster. You're going to see good news, bad news, good news, bad news. You're going to feel like it's going to work, it's not going to work. But they've got to do all of those things, and they can't do them all at once. They have the will, you know, because all the politicians say there is no plan B. The way is really complicated.
I expect we'll return to that, but let's just keep globetrotting for a second. You've got the international financial meetings in Japan, and one of the things obviously coming out is the IMF predictions for slowdown in global economic growth. Alcoa announced this morning the dropping off of global demand for aluminum, which is something of an indicator. Are you seeing the same thing in your business operations? Is it in all your business around the world, because you know, you're a truly international institution, are you seeing signs of slowdown?
No, not quite like that. So Europe is in a mild recession. You all see it. So you could argue it's surprised not worse. But the governments there do spend 50% of the money, so that 50% will not go down. And Asia is slower, but it's nothing mystical or different than you read about in the newspapers. And the United States, which we'll talk about a little bit, is fundamentally stronger than people think, in my opinion. And I'll give you the reasons for that a little bit later. And Latin America, you know, some are better and some are slower, but obviously it's slowed down quite a bit.
Asia, you seem sanguine about. What about, I mean, India clearly slowing, China clearly slowing?
Right. You know, here's how I put China. China, an opinion, I think they're going to meet their objectives of like 7 or 8% growth. Remember, it used to be a lot higher.
Right.
They need the 7 or 8% to employ the 8 million people, to avoid the social unrest, and to build all the infrastructure. I think they're going to meet that because I think they're actually quite bright. There's a change of leadership coming. We think the change of leadership will be smooth and will continue the former policies of the government. But they have the wherewithal to do it. So they've got, you know, $3 trillion reserves and a lot of capability to maintain growth at 7%. They move very quickly. So you may remember the United States did a stimulus package after the crisis, and I think it was like 7 months after the crisis. They did it that month, literally. So they have the ability to move quickly. They know what they want to accomplish. But I don't believe that China can do that 10 years from now. I think that now they have an economy that can macro-manage and infrastructure building still works. They're still not building a lot of bridges to nowhere. I think down the road that doesn't work. I think it'll work in the immediate, you know, for the next couple of years.
And are you as bullish as a lot of other people about Africa these days and Latin America? Are you seeing the signs of pretty robust economic growth there?
Africa is, you got to go country by country. So we're opening offices and we do business in a lot of countries there, but we're on the ground in a big way in South Africa. But in Sub-Sahara, we're opening offices this year in Ghana and Kenya. And we go there for the multinationals. So if you ask me who are your clients, they're multinational clients. And when they go, we go. So it isn't a mystical type of thing. So yes, optimistic, but it's country by country. And you really got to think it that way. And same with Latin America. So we're in Colombia and Peru, and Chile's doing fine. And Brazil's clearly slowed down, but we'll be making consistent investments in all of those countries. And Mexico also, we think, is actually doing quite well. So our neighbors to the south have done a better job with the fiscal deficit, a better job with monetary policy, a better job creating jobs down there. So we should help as much as we can on the drug problem they're having.
Well, implicit in a lot of this is we're not
which
doing...
Which is our drug problem, too. So.
Implicit in a lot of what you're saying is we're not doing, we the United States, as well as we should. So let's turn inward. How worried are you and how much are you planning for the fiscal cliff?
Right. So, that's the big deal, is that when the Eurozone crisis happens or the debt ceiling crisis, we spend, I'm going to say, $50 to $100 million getting prepared for the debt ceiling crisis. Because of the complexity of what would happen in global financial markets if you had a real failure. The fiscal cliff isn't quite that, because it's more predictable what some of these outcomes will be. But we're forming now a fiscal cliff war room, command center, and all that kind of stuff, going through to make sure we understand all of it. And we'll be prepared. I mean, JPMorgan will survive a fiscal cliff. And I just think it's terrible policy to allow it to get close. And the reason I think it's bad is because I read the paper this morning, someone said it isn't that bad, it's just so much GDP. There are all these potential outcomes, and I would defy any one of you to really know what they are. Therefore, it's irresponsible policy just to say, well, let's see. Let's not see. I mean, I think as risk managers say, let's try to avoid that. And it'll happen. It won't happen on midnight December 31st. It's going to happen now and right after the election, when people start to say, this is bad, and they just start to make decisions at the margin. Don't hire, don't build, don't buy, let's just wait and see. Well, that is a recession, just people pulling back a little bit, and you know, let's not do that to ourselves.
Do you agree with people who say it's actually better to describe it less as a cliff than as a slope, almost for the reasons you're saying?
Then it'll be a slope going into December 30th, yeah.
And then after that?
Yeah, probably, yeah.
What about the more fundamental thing? Imagine we get through the fiscal cliff, less because we concoct an omnibus deal, but rather because Congress finds a way to kick the proverbial can down the road. How worried are you at some point if the United States can't do something on the order of a Simpsons bowl, $4 trillion over a decade kind of comprehensive deal? How worried are you that one day you wake up and suddenly your BlackBerry or iPhone is red hot because the bond markets essentially move against the United States?
It's virtually assured. I mean, it's assured. The question is when and how. And so, you know, I can't honestly tell you, I know it's going to be 2 years or 5 years, but it will happen. It is a matter of time. You know, the United States can't borrow indefinitely, and you've seen it, but if you don't believe me, look at, you know, over the 100 years, bankruptcies of country after country after country who just thought they could get away with it because of the reserve currency, the military power of the world. So, you know, again, it's why would you take the choice, let's wait and see. So we are going to have fiscal discipline. It is imposed upon us, or we do the right thing, we do it to ourselves the right way. And in a way, in fact, I think could enhance growth and jobs. You know, so we did something like a Simpson Bowles. I believe had that been done, you know, when it was a year ago, whatever, I think this economy would have been booming. But we, and not just because it would have shown that we have the ability. I would say America knows the way. We don't have the will. Like Europe, I said, no, it has the will, but doesn't know the way. A more efficient tax system. It would have created much more certainty among a whole bunch of policy things. I think we would have been booming. I still think it's doable. I just, you know, we need the leaders to say we are going to do it.
And when you think of the outlines of something on the, if you want to call it Simpson Bowles for shorthand, is it your sense that it does have to include, you know, the basic elements, something with entitlement reform, something with spending controls, something with tax increases?
Yeah, I think most business people are not partisan and not parochial. I mean, you know, folks, we can't spend, you know, we can all sit here and decide we're going to spend 20% of the government, 21%, and I think Simpson Bowles was 21%. And then obviously you have taxes to do it. Let's have an efficient tax system. So Simpson Bowles has a far more efficient tax system. So it gets this huge waste and churn, I call it friction costs in our society, from a bad tax system, a polluted, you know, legal system, uncertainty around things. So yeah, I think you would have had better growth. And Simpson Bowles, I think, was 4-for-1 or whatever it was, but close enough would have been good enough. I mean, it doesn't have to be exactly right. If it gets growth going again, you know, remember, growth will pay for a lot once we have growth starting again. So
let's talk about growth, because the United States has been now for several years growing at roughly half what you might call the modern historical rate of economic growth. So instead of growing in the mid-threes, we're growing in the, you know, just below two, give or take. If you were advising the next president, be it Mr. Obama or Mr. Romney, if you were in a position to more broadly make the case publicly, here's the couple of things that we ought to do in order to generate double our rate of economic growth, say to 3.5%. One would obviously be some kind of a comprehensive budget deal like you just mentioned. What else would be on Jamie Dimon's list?
Okay, so let me give you the big picture about America, this great country of ours, okay? The president, whoever he is next, should recognize one thing for certain. They're going into that office with a royal straight flush. I think this attitude somehow, how woe is me, how terrible, that America's lost, it's just not true, folks. I mean, and those of you who travel around the world, we have the best military on the planet, we will for years. We have the widest, deepest, most transparent capital markets, in spite of what happened. They're still the best, I'm talking about in all of its glory. Asset management, venture capital, private equity, you know, the actual markets, municipal bond markets. We have the among the best businesses on the planet, small, medium, and large. We're one of the most innovative entrepreneurial country around. And I'm not talking about Steve Jobs, I'm talking about all up and down the factory line, Steve Jobs, you name it. We invest more in capital equipment. We have a good rule of law. It's no longer the best, because I think we have a slightly polluted tort system at this point. We still have a very, the Protestant work ethic is still there. Okay, this is still the best economy in the world. If you're going to invest one place in this planet, it would be here. So we've got to get beyond that, you know, somehow this is a terrible change. Now, we don't have a divine right to success. We got to get immigration right, fiscal policy right, otherwise we'll, oh wait, we just had another gift called shale oil. I mean, my God, the most profligate energy nation on the planet. I mean, God looked down upon us and said, I know you wasted all that energy policy, we're going to give you one more shot. So let's hope we do this one right. So we have a problem. We should diagnose the problem. And, you know, if you look at America today, corporations are in great shape, middle market companies are in good shape, small business is in better shape, consumers are not in bad shape, and housing is turning. Why are we going to 2%? And this one, I can't prove. And but I believe that the setting's okay. Europe isn't going to sink us. We might sink them. But there's a huge wet blanket out here, okay? And the wet blanket to me is all the uncertainty around, or you could say real uncertainty around taxes, policies, fiscal cliff. We have the debt ceiling fiasco. We have this constant anti-business, not just sentiment, but regulatory AGs. So where I travel all around America. Wherever I go, I ask business people, how do you feel about the regulatory environment? They all say it's terrible. So it's not just banks. We've done it to ourselves, folks. We're shooting ourselves in the foot, and we're doing it every day. Get rid of that wet blanket, and this thing will take off. And there was a great article that was written, someone reprinted in the Wall Street Journal, and it was, I remember George Shultz and Milton Friedman, and who gave President-elect Ronald Reagan some advice. And it was basically that, consistent taxes, consistent regulatory, tell the same positive story over and over and over, and it will turn. And you got to believe in it. So, you know, America usually, as Winston Churchill said, will do the right thing after it's exhausted all of the possibilities. You know, I'm hoping we do. But the important part to me also is in Washington, okay? Hey, if you think that Washington and business can go to war with each other and it's going to be good, terrible error. I mean, collaboration is what should happen. We should have had collaboration. We were in a crisis. Every business I know wanted to help and get things done, you know, and would have pulled together, worked around the clock, but it became a war. And now we're relitigating parts of those wars, you know, Dodd-Frank and healthcare, and, you know, so we're going to relitigate it. So it's another addition to the wet blanket. And, you know, the better thing to do is to get it right the first time, and move on. But we didn't.
Let's transition to that. To the extent there has been a marked absence of collaboration or significant friction between the worlds of politics and the worlds of business, Would you put the lion's share of the responsibility on the political side?
I would put more on the political side than the business side, because the BRT, the business CEOs, everyone I know is coming down and saying, what can we do to help? They, you know, there were councils, there were meetings. Matter of fact, the BRT even wanted for the first time, which surprised me, when someone had asked a question, these are 120 CEOs of fairly big companies, do you want universal health care for American citizens? 80% said yes. Now, they wanted it done right a certain way, so a lot of them don't agree with the way it was done. But yeah, there was a huge effort. Let's pull together as Americans and make this work, whatever it took. And it didn't happen. I don't know. You know politics far better than I do. But it didn't happen. It still could happen, by the way. So my attitude is, you know, let's do it again. Let's try again. Let's, you know, we owe it to ourselves to do the best we can.
One area that you clearly know better than I do is regulation and regulatory policy. So let me put that out there. You know, historically, you know, one often talks of pendulum swings. And I think there's something of conventional wisdom that pre-2008, the pendulum had swung too far in the direction of under-regulation. And then the danger is obviously after 2008, at least one school of thought is that it's gone too far. There's another school of thought I'll come to in a second, still hasn't gone far enough. Where do you come out on that?
You know, first, when I read a lot of people who have deep opinions and little knowledge, and then a lot of them use whatever fact they find to justify what they already thought, which is not the way you're going to come with a good policy. So first of all, let's be clear. We need good regulation in America. Good regulation is a good thing. Good doesn't mean necessarily more or less. It just means good. Highways post 65 miles per hour. You can't drink when you drive. Those are good things done properly. In some of these areas, we created such confusion. No one knows who's responsible for what. Overlapping jurisdictions, no way to adjudicate disputes. You know, when people do commit, you know, not fraud, but, you know, they make mistakes, you know, you're attacked by 17 different agencies, as opposed to, you know, in the old days, it would be the one who's responsible for it. So we need good policy, clarity, simplicity. So a lot of those people arguing on the financial side, they need more. What they're saying is more capital. More, well, okay, fine. What's the level of capital that makes sense? Let's have the debate and look at the facts. And, you know, I've always been supportive of a lot of capital, a lot of liquidity. I think at one point it's going to go too far. And maybe it is that point. I think a lot of the, you know, some of these laws, by the way, are laws written in Basel. They're not written here. So not written for America. They're written for other people, for other purposes. And, you know, of course, the regulators say, we have to have a common, you know, we want to do it right and make it fair for everybody. I agree with that concept, except it was bad for America. Because if America doesn't want to do it, the rest of the world can't make us. And I'm not being overly thin, but if you looked at some of these rules, you'd say that those didn't make sense for this country. So
What about in the poster child or poster issue of proprietary trading and the Volcker rule and all that? Where do you come out on that?
So the Volcker, so after Dodd-Frank was mostly done, and after the blueprint and the white paper, and after everyone threw their 2 cents in it, then the Volcker rule was thrown on top. So I would argue it was completely unnecessary, totally unnecessary. But it wasn't the problem. So if you look at a lot of things at Dodd-Frank, we support a lot of Dodd-Frank, and we support good reform. The Democrats always make it, and I'm still barely one, binary. You're either for or against it. There are like 2,000 things in Dodd-Frank. And I'm for some and I'm against some, and I can tell you exactly why and what makes sense. A lot of them had nothing to do with the crisis. The Volcker had nothing to do with the crisis, just something that Paul felt deeply about. If you ask me the intent of the Volcker law, keep trading safe for big financial companies, I agree with that. And we got to get rid of too big to fail. We should talk about that in a second, too. So I agree with the intent. And so prop trading, we don't do any prop trading. What I've said, and which is important, is we have the widest, deepest, best, most transparent capital markets in the world. I didn't bring my little thing, but you can price almost anything on my little BlackBerry within pennies and pips. Let's not throw the baby out the bathwater. So the struggle is trying to define how you restrict market making through Volcker. And you almost can't. Because what the law almost leaves it so vague that it's hard to determine what's proprietary, what's market making. And so I just hope we write it in a way that we end up with the widest, deepest, and best and most capital markets in the world. But that's what I hope. And what happened, the regulators came out with there's like 180 things in there. They've gotten 18,000 comment letters from around the world, not just from American investment banks, but from around the world, asset managers, central banks, governments. Let's just get it right. And at one point, it's got to be a dialogue, not just people going off in the dark room and deciding what the answer is to it.
But in general, ought there to be, should most regulation come, if you will, from the outside, or should firms essentially have a large role in self-policing, so long as it's transparent?
I think that you should have, regulation should be formed and designed with practitioners, too. And right in this crisis, because banks were blamed for everything, is keep them out of the process. And that's kind of a mistake, because that's like if you're designing a hospital, keep the doctors out. Now, of course, banks made mistakes. Bad banks should be punished. But it would have been better to sit down and have the conversation, design improvements to the system than we ended up doing, which is people just dumping 2,000, 5,000 pages of rules, trying to figure out what they mean. And some of these rules, by the way, and here I'm a big bank, there is in our great economic ecosystem plays for all different types of entities. Small banks, medium-sized banks, big banks. We bank certain companies in 50 countries. That's why we're here. We do a lot of things that other people can't do. Some of these rules are going to be terrible for small banks. Now, I'm saying that because I support them. They say, I don't want them coming after me. The small banks also blame the big banks. But who's the biggest banker to banks? JPMorgan.
Well, let's talk about that. Yeah. You mentioned too big to fail. There's talk that you ought to be broken up, that simply if you ever did get into serious financial distress, that you would be system threatening, if you will. It goes way beyond the institution. How does one deal with that? I mean, how do you, other than that people have tremendous faith in you or one day your successors, how do we deal with the problem that if J.P. Morgan ever made an institution threatening mistake, that the ramifications would be far larger?
So people talk about Glass-Steagall and bankrupt. So this crisis had nothing to do with Glass-Steagall. Okay, you may remember hedge funds had problems early on, mortgage brokers, savings and loans went bankrupt, IndyMac, PennyMac, WaMu, which we ended up buying, monoline investment banks, which wasn't Glass-Steagall, Lehman and Bear Stearns, AIG, a life insurance company, and then the biggest financial catastrophes of all time called Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. That all happened way before it hit a bank. So it wasn't a Glass-Steagall foundation. That's number one. Number two is we have to get rid of too big to fail. So if I was sitting in any other seat other than my own, I'd say, you should never pay if J.P. Morgan fails. You need a way to bankrupt, and I prefer bankruptcy. It should be called minimally damaging bankruptcy for big, dumb banks, as opposed to this vague concept of orderly liquidation or resolution. It kind of sounds like you're resolving us, but we may still be around. I think it should be called bankruptcy. Matter of fact, I think Kevin Warsh recommended Chapter 14. It needs specialized stuff, because just like in a hospital, when it goes bankrupt, you can't turn the lights off because they may be operating. In a financial company, all you need is the money keeps on running through the system. It doesn't get locked up. It could be done. In fact, it was done quite successfully by the FDIC for a long period of time. And so I do think there are ways that you want to structure us legally and stuff so that the regulators say, if J.P. Morgan starts to fail and they file Chapter 14, here's what happens. The money keeps on moving. The equity holders and the unsecured holders pay everything. If there's any money lost, there won't. You know, J.P. Morgan has $400 billion of equity and unsecured debt. Okay, and there's no way we're going to lose all that. But if it did, it would be charged back to the big banks, just like FDIC is today. So the citizens never pay. And also, I think when that failure happens, all clawbacks are invoked, all management is fired, all directors are fired, and the name is buried forever. And so that we remember why, you know, it shouldn't happen. So it shouldn't hurt the economy and stuff like that, and I agree with that. So those are what we should be doing, fixing that particular problem. You know, like I said, if J.P. Morgan, presumably the reason companies get bigger and stuff like that is we offer things to clients. You know, like better, faster, cheaper. That is capitalism. Productivity, growth, enhancements, and you buy it from us or whoever you buy it from because you like it. You go to Walmart because you like the price. Just like when you go to our trading desk, you come to our trading desk because you like the price. Nothing wrong with that. Not immoral. Perfectly reasonable. And I tell people we didn't have productivity enhancement. If we didn't have productivity, we'd all be living in tent and hunting buffalo. That is what created this great economy of ours. There's some negatives to it. Sometimes industries lose and, you know, some things don't survive. But look what's happened over hundreds of years. It's a wonderful, beautiful thing. So we got to get rid of too big to fail. Create it like a Chapter 14, which I think they're very close on that one, by the way. This one, I do think Dodd-Frank has the elements of that embedded in Dodd-Frank. And let companies compete in the marketplace.
Implicit or even explicit in what you just said is that you're not going to get to that point. Obviously, you know, several months ago you had the derivatives experience, subject in part of the New York Times, Sunday Magazine this week, the profile of Ina Drew and all that. What is different about risk management now? What if you will, are the lessons learned and changes implemented at the bank?
Yeah, so this company, JPMorgan Chase, Bank One, it went through 06, 07, 08, 09, 2010, 2011, 2012, never lost money in a quarter, didn't need TARP, and was there for a lot of people and others weren't. California, New Jersey, Illinois, hospitals, schools, businesses. And we bought Bear Stearns at the request of the United States government. We bought WaMu for ourselves. We were able to probably save 15 or 20,000 jobs and a tremendous cost on the FDIC, which would have been passed back to other banks. So, you know, we made a stupid error. I mean, we're pretty disciplined risk people, you know, but we made an error. We had a gap in the line. And, you know, we didn't have this gap elsewhere. We have other flaws elsewhere, but we didn't, you know, we had a gap. We screwed up, you know, and by the way, that quarter, we made $5 billion. So, yeah, it was a stupid error. I'm not going to say, I could never, and it was really intensely stupid. If I actually took you through it, it's kind of embarrassing personally, too. I should have caught it also. I didn't, you know, but it isn't going to sink our ship. We have $150 billion of capital, and we earned $5 billion that quarter. Analysts have us at a record year this year, third year in a row. That's our job. You know, companies make mistakes. I mean, if an airplane crashes, should we stop flying all airplanes? They're pretty complex. Ever looked inside an airplane? If a drug doesn't work, should we stop all drug manufacturing? I mean, so we better be really careful. We say, okay, well, J.P. Morgan had this mistake, and then draw conclusions which are really not proper. And, you know, punish us for our mistake, which is really a shareholder mistake. It didn't cost anyone else any money. And the board's doing its own independent review. And I could tell you that gap doesn't exist most other places. There are some lessons learned which we're embedding across the whole company. Businesses make mistakes, they learn from it, and they get better for it. That is what business is. You know, when I come to Washington do people act like, you know, making a mistake should never happen. Of course it happens. Only academics and politicians, you know, somehow is not allowed.
I won't take that last comment personally. Why don't I open it up at this point? I might have one or two at the end I wanna close with. But let me open up. Wait for a microphone. Let us know your name and your affiliation. I see a gentleman there, about right next to the microphone. Yes, sir.
Father Andrew from the Vatopedi Monastery on Mount Athos. In August, The Economist reported that the Roman Catholic Church spent approximately $171.6 billion in 2010. About $18 billion of that was financed through municipal tax-free municipal bond purchases. What is JP Morgan doing to help faith-based organizations borrow to meet our capital needs over the long term? I mean, right now is a good climate for us. For example, my monastery is 1,600 years old. We would want to borrow now and pay it over time.
How much do you want to borrow?
What rate?
You asked a great question, because we bank governments, not-for-profits, hospitals. I know we bank churches, and I just don't know the actual numbers. I'd be happy to share them with you if you want to send me an email and give you a banker who could tell you what we can and can't do. And that's, part of what we do is we advise people what is reasonable, what's not reasonable. In the lending business, you've got to be very careful. A bank, unlike other institutions, often has to say no to a client. If you walk into Walmart, they want to sell you whatever you have cash for. A bank shouldn't, because if we give you money you shouldn't borrow, we're going to get blamed for that too. So, sometimes they say to you, no, we're not going to do it, and it's not good for you either. It's like selling, too much liquor to someone, or letting them have that fifth drink at the bar or whatever. And so, I'll give you all the help. I mean, send me an email, I'll give you all the information you need.
Why don't take a slightly broader answer to that question. Take 1 minute, talk about your definition. Here you are, this large organization, you have enormous profits. What is your sense of corporate social responsibility? What sort of program? What does JP Morgan define for itself as the things it should be doing?
Yeah, so this is, I've never had a conflict over this. The people, shareholder value. My job is to build a healthy, vibrant company. And I want, in every community we operate in, including Greece, Italy, and Spain, and every hamlet, we're in 2,000 hamlets around the world, for you to think we're a good corporate citizen. No different, and I really do mean this, than that corner store. That corner store participates in the community. They help the Little League or the local church. They participate. They give people summer jobs. They have a little bit of philanthropy sometimes. And we do that everywhere. We do it through a foundation. We'd be the seventh largest foundation in America. We do almost $200 million a year. Corporate social responsibility around environmental. We have programs for Global Cities Initiative, which my friend Peter Scheer started here, which we're going to lots of cities and to help them grow economically and create jobs and healthy environments. We do a tremendous amount for education and veterans. We've hired, and if you're a veteran in this room, thank you very much for your service to the country. We've hired 4,800 veterans this year, or in the last 18 months or so. There's this thing called the 100,000 jobs thing, which we helped start. There are now 78 companies. They've hired 28,000 veterans, and we've done 4,500 ourselves. So while a lot of people are talking, we're doing. And if you go to football games, you're going to see us giving homes away to wounded veterans. We've done 200 homes. We're going to do, before this program's over, like 1,000. So we try to participate. And to me, it's all the same thing. Healthy, vibrant company makes it all possible. A sick, dying company, none of it's possible. And that's why I try to remind people all the time. And I'll put in that same thing, by the way. People say, as an employee, the shareholder, if I don't make customers happy, there is no anything else. If we don't make employees do a good job, so they're all important to me. I've never separated them. Just run a good business, try to earn a fair profit, always invest for the future, take care of your own people and your clients, and in that you'll be making mistakes. And then, let me go back to this mistake issue one more time. So here's a question for you all. Make believe you're my board of directors. We have something like $15 billion of exposure, net of derivatives and hedging, all the stuff like that, and it bounces around. But make believe it's 15 in Italy and Spain. You could easily tell me, get it down. I can get it down. I'd have to do some derivatives to get it down, but I can get it down. On the other hand, we've been in Italy and Spain for over 100 years. J.P. Morgan himself died in Rome, loved Italy. And if you were Italy, how would you feel if J.P. Morgan cuts and runs? So what you want is, you say, okay, well, J.P. Morgan, don't be a fair weather friend. Be here in good times and bad times for me, which is what we're doing. We bank the government, the central bank, huge corporations. And I know, and I've told my board, that we can lose $5, $6 billion just like that if things go bad. Now, if I'm sitting up here, and I'm sure I'll be dragged down to Congress again. Everyone knew that Italy and Spain were going to go bad. How could you not have known? What kind of risk management do you have? We made a decision. I may be the wrong decision. One, we made a stupid error. This is not a stupid. This is a deliberate, we're going to stay, and we hope we've been doing business there in 50 years. And we know the risk we're bearing right now, and we try to moderate them, but we need to be a good corporate citizen. So if you go around the world, by the way, I'm lucky. I simply stand on the shoulders of those who came before. The reputation and the knowledge that J.P. Morgan has and the relationships inside these countries, they go back 100 years. And so we can't cut and run. And we're not going to. We're going to try to manage the exposures, but we're going to be long-term investors?
I'll try to get as many people as I can. Oda Aberdeen in the front row here.
Oda Aberdeen, the Capital Trust Group. Mr. Dimon, when you look at J.P. Morgan of Lou Preston and J.P. Morgan of today, what's the difference? And I'd like you to comment on the issue of oversight. I listened to you. You made a persuasive argument, but I haven't heard you use the word oversight.
Yeah, when you say oversight, I mean, we have boards and regulators, I have more oversight than you could possibly imagine. When you say the difference, we are in a different world, but we do the same thing for consumers and businesses. We lend the money. Some big corporate, we raise money in equity. We raise it in the markets for them. We don't lend it directly, but it's almost the same. So if you come to us and say, well, I want to borrow money for this project, we may say, well, your cheapest route is a bank loan, or it might be going to the public markets. And around that, all these new products and services called derivatives, but 99% of all corporations use them, and most of them are interest rates and foreign exchange, stuff that people have been doing for a long time to manage their exposures. Consumers, same thing. Okay, so the other thing for corporations, we run your checking accounts. We move something like $5 to $10 trillion a day for corporations around the world. So it's all electronic, it's all systems, but that's your checking account. We move it through different currencies to different countries to pay your vendors for, again, these are for the 6,000 huge corporations and governments around the world. And for consumers too, we give you advice. You have savings accounts, checking accounts, investment accounts, mortgages, auto loans. That's what we do. Those fundamental things aren't going to change 100 years from now. You're still going to need financial advice and help as an individual and as a corporation, and we'll still be doing it. The products may change. The services may change. The oversight, we have a board, which is very strong and very tough and is doing its own independent review of this whole fiasco we just had. We have regulators, and the OCC, the FDIC, the Fed. Inside J.P. Morgan Chase, we've got every business has a risk committee. We have, I'm going to say, 2,000 people in risk, 1,000 lawyers, 1,500 compliance officers, 1,000 credit officers. I mean, there's huge oversight inside the company to try to manage this as we do it. But at the end of the day, it's one client. What are we doing for them that they want or don't want in a way they want? And then the market-making one, which confuses most people. We make markets in 30 countries. We buy and sell a couple $1 trillion a day. But think of it as you can go to us in Hong Kong, London, or New York and buy bonds. They could be the Columbia Republic bonds, or they could be GM bonds. What do you want from us? Great research, great execution, great price. We're the store. We sell you that. Like I use my example of Costco or Walmart. It's a little riskier than that because it's a little more volatile business. But that's how we get your business. We do a great job for you. And you say, you guys give me great price, and you always give me great service and great ideas. That's why you get my business. And we'll hopefully continue to do that. That market making, by the way, is integral to the fact that IBM can call us up right now and raise $5 billion in the bond market in hours. They're directly related because we make markets in those bonds. We know who the investors are. We do research. We have the capability to do it. That's how they can do it. You go to countries that don't have that kind of market making, they can't issue bonds like that. So they're related like this.
Yeah, right there in the fifth row. I can scurry about with microphones. That would be good.
Thank you. I'm David Apgar. I'm a risk and performance manager. Here's a way of getting at the question of what makes for good regulation. Why didn't FDCIA live up to the hope that it would keep banks from getting in trouble operating between the mortgage markets and the securitization markets? That was the hope when it was passed after the thrift crisis. And it's probably a good test case because it was a combination of things, as I recall. There was a lot of micro regulation that drove everyone nuts, and at least one kind of novel idea that a number of bankers thought was interesting, which was let the supervisors come in before equity is entirely gone so that the managers aren't tempted to take big risks. So why didn't that help forestall the latest financial crisis?
If you're going to look at the latest financial crisis, financial crisis is a little more complex than one thing. We had too much leverage in the system. The mortgage market was polluted. There was too much leverage everywhere. There's far more leverage in Europe than the United States. That's not an accusation of Europe. That's what the regime they operate under, both regulatory and political, for 30 years. More wholesale unsecured funding, much more leverage. Much more stuff is done through banks than the capital market. So, but like I said, the mortgage business, Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac were a huge disaster. I've yet to see, I don't know, they're dragging me down, but I'd love to see someone go through what happened there. How can, and that's going to cost you $200 billion, by the way. JP Morgan's not going to cost you anything. So, you know, we should be asking questions like that. So I think you should go through all those things and ask what we can do better. So we wanted an oversight committee called FSOC to adjudicate and also assign responsibility to problems and to the people responsible for it. You know, we thought there should be a better bankruptcy failure resolution mechanism for big banks. We've always believed in more capital liquidity. I'm generally a believer in transparency. We thought a lot of derivatives should go to clearinghouses. But again, you know, they're the devil's in the detail, folks. A clearinghouse does not eliminate risk. It concentrates it and standardizes it. But if you don't set up that clearinghouse right, you'll have a problem down the road. So those things need to be structured properly, too. And
yes, ma'am, all the way in the back.
Hi, I'm Justine Underhill from RT. So you mentioned that companies make mistakes, and now that there's a civil lawsuit for Bear Stearns related to related fraud, do you regret participating with the Federal Reserve to buy Bear Stearns in 2008?
We didn't participate with the Federal Reserve, okay?
Did you miss something when you told investors that Bear Stearns, the acquisition, would not be material?
Well, I'm not sure I ever said that. So Bear Stearns, we were asked to buy Bear Stearns. Someone said the Fed did us a favor to finance some of stuff like that. No, we did them a favor. I mean, let's get this one exactly right. We were asked to do it. We did it at great risk to ourselves, and we had the capability and capital and people to do extensive due diligence. The one thing I was terrified about was, you know, had they gone bankrupt, all these lawsuits would be no money. There'd be no lawsuits. There'd be no stock drop lawsuits. There'd be no class action lawsuits. There'd be no mortgage lawsuits because there'd be no money. But we bought it. And the second we bought it, we knew we had some, you know, we were buying some, as some reporters point out. I've written extensively about, would I have done Bear Stearns again, knowing what I know today? It's real close. It's really close. I will not, but what I know today, if they called me at the end to do something again like that, I couldn't do it. My board wouldn't allow me, because you're taking on these obligations. I did get a letter from one of the senior regulators late on Sunday night, before we signed it, that said, please take in consideration when you want to come after us down the road for something Bear Stearns did, that JP was asked to do this by the federal government. And we've been very honest with the shows about the economic and financial effects of Bear Stearns. We have some great things with Bear Stearns, you know, some businesses and their building and some great people and some terrible things. And I forgot the exact number, but I'm going to say we've lost $5 to $10 billion on various things related to Bear Stearns now. And yes, I put it in the unfair category. Hey, I'm a big boy. I'll survive. We were very honest with our shareholders. But I think the government should think twice before they punish businesses every single time something goes wrong.
You say when you said lost 5 or 10, that's billion. A net, you mean?
Out of litigation, certain write-downs, you know, and the financing the Fed did, you know, was $30 billion in mortgages. We kept the non-investment-grade mortgages. I asked them to take the investment-grade mortgages. I told them we have to borrow more, we borrow more leverage. I didn't want to create another teetering giant in the marketplace. I also told them, if you hold these things, since you guys borrow at 0%, you'll get all your money back, which they said, we won't. I said, you'll get all your money back. But they've gotten all their money back, and they're going to make a multi-billion-dollar profit. Okay? Multi-billion.
Talk about borrowing at 0%.
I should have negotiated that you have that whatever the extra billions are, you got to give it back to me to pay for the litigation costs.
Should have, could have.
Next time I will.
Talk about borrowing at 0% and low interest rates. Are you worried that in the course of your career, inflation is going to become issue number one for you? Or at least
you talk about planning. Again, people talk about base, you know, the Treasury may move to, it's like 175 or so, this morning might move to 2 or 250. I'm worried about 5 or 10%. This company's going to be prepared for much bigger, higher, not right away. I don't see any reason why it happened right away. Now, by the way, I want to point out, I think the Fed, by the way, has been an adult in town and done a magnificent job. And their QE1, 2, and 3, if added together, are $3 trillion so far. You all know what the financial assets of America are? $80 trillion. And the reason I'm pointing it out is because people have mentioned to me Argentina, the Weimar Republic, runaway inflation. No, there was far more stimulus than that. Like, it was GDP every year and financial assets. So I think the economy, like I said, things are in pretty sound shape. There's been a lot of fiscal monetary stimulation. I think it's kind of like on the ground, unused. We think corporate America has $1.5 trillion of too much cash, and some of it overseas. We think consumers are probably, if I asked you for a show of hands, how many of you hold too much cash in your own portfolios? My guess is a lot of you say, yeah, I'm scared, and you know, I'm holding more cash and stuff like that. And so, yeah, if you have a runaway, if you have real growth, you're going to start people talking about inflation. So here's, I look at the best case, worst case. The best case is we start to grow 4%, you know, capacity utilization goes up, inflation goes to, you know, 3% or 3.5%. The Fed removes some of the stimulus. Bond rates, the 10-year will go to 5 and short run goes to 3. That'd be great. It's possible, by the way. The worst case is what I call stagflation. That we're not only we're not growing, but now you start to see inflation. We've had that before in this country. And I think what the Fed needs now is good fiscal policy.
Something they don't
control.
I think
the Fed needs good fiscal policy, folks. And you all got to get on board that. That's what's going to kill this thing, not Fed policy. Is that we don't get our act together on controlling our fiscal deficit in the future.
You just talked about corporations bringing some of the money back home. I assume then you would favor a change in corporate taxation?
Yeah, the corporate taxation system doesn't work, you know, and I try to explain to my, and they say, well, prove it. You know, it's hard to prove some of these things like in real time. I always say, you know that book called they wrote the book This Time is Different, and they said a financial crisis takes a long time getting out of. Well, if you read the 5 or 6 examples, it's because of bad policy. It didn't have to be that way. I think, and I'm convinced that Ben Bernanke Jr. will write a book down the road saying, it could have been a lot better. We could have made this a lot better. And one of the things is taxation. We are driving brainy immigrants back. They get trained here and send them back home. And we're driving capital at the margin. Don't argue all capital. Some companies, they earn money, they have to invest here. They're not here. But if you're building a semiconductor plant or a shipbuilding plant or a data center or a research center or a farmer's, it doesn't have to be here. And a lot of it, those decisions will be made over there because their taxes are lower and they don't have to pay the repatriation tax, which makes the returns 30-40% higher. And you know, and that's not because they're immoral, folks. That is economics. And what I beg my Democratic friends is separate morality from economics. Set up the economic system that's conducive to growth, conducive to jobs, conducive to GDP, and then we'll have a conversation about taxation. So, for example, I don't mind paying 39.6% taxes. I don't mind my capital gains or stuff being at 20%. I want a society which is always getting more equitable. I think that's a good thing. Don't mess up the economic engine that made it all possible. And that's the problem with what we're doing. And you could talk to business people all day long. It's kind of anecdotal. Like I said, it'll be academic 10 years from now. It's anecdotal today that we're driving capital and brains overseas. And the problem with that, by the way, the other problem is when they make those investments overseas, they're also sending engineers, R&D, and other people over there. And some of them may stay.
Well, our immigration policy is doing that, too. Peter Ackerman.
Right. Hi, Jerry. Peter Ackerman, Rockport Capital. Since the crisis, I've had numerous conversations with people who I consider very intelligent who'll say something like this to me. We have to return Glass-Steagall by instituting the Volcker Rule. Or we have to basically restrict the banks from taking any positions in a variety of securities that are their bread and butter. And when I tell them you can't underwrite without making markets, it just passes over their head. It seems to me that the industry itself, and maybe it's because of the political din that created post-recession, is just could do a better job explaining to average Americans what your business is and what you're required to do to make the business work for the customer. What do you think?
Yeah, look, obviously you want to do a better job, and everyone in my industry is talking about how you can earn back trust and do a better job and explain some of these things. You know, I think. And it's really a multiple thing here, because a lot of people are saying things they don't know and just don't understand. And I think it's incumbent upon the leaders to make sure we have intelligent conversations. We don't politicize things for the sake of, you know, politics. And, you know, the banks lost, and I didn't realize this, and you can punish me for this too. When they said that all the banks failed and were bailed out, the game was over. That was it. And if you really believe that, then some of that anger was completely justified. But that predicated on those two lies, is the banks solely caused the problem, and they all would have failed. All other things, they're almost defenseless. You almost can't defend yourself at all. And those things aren't true. Not all banks would have failed. You know, some of these banks were ports. JPMorgan was a port in the storm, but so was Wells Fargo. So were a lot of the regional banks out there. They weren't going to fail. They didn't need TARP to succeed. They were trying to make loans and do what they had to do in times of need for America. And so it's hard to make the case. And I don't know how to do it, but I'm not going to give up. I mean, I love this country too much. I'm not giving up. That's why I do some of these things like this. And that's why I talk about the wisest and deepest and most transparent capital markets. And in my chairman's letter, which I get help from the lady sitting right behind you, in fact, but and my wife, but I describe capital markets. What is market making? Why is it a set? Why is market making in lumber, aluminum, grass? Not grass, grass, you know, like
thank you for clarifying.
There's market making in everything. That's what. Right, there's market making. There was market making in communist China, in the Soviet Union. There are markets in Cuba. I mean, I don't know what people think when they talk about market. That's what people do. They go, you know, if you can sell your goods for a better price over here than over here, you go over there. That's what people do. That's what each and every one of you would do. It's not like there's a morality around that. And some of it, I don't know, we're teaching people all the wrong things. But banks should acknowledge there were flaws, and they should be fixed. We should be punished for what we did wrong. The punishment should fit the crime, and not that we all commit the same crimes, so we can move on. And I do think the American public feels there was no, like, Old Testament justice. What they saw, banks bailed out, and all these people make all that money, and including the banks that failed, people made all that money. And there's some truth to that. There is some truth to that. I can't make up for what other boards did and didn't do, but there is truth to that. There were people who destroyed their companies, virtually brought the United States down to its knees, and walked away with $50 million. Pisses me off, too.
Just to defend the Old Testament for a second. when the Old Testament came up with the idea of an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, that was an innovation. The idea was that punishment should not exceed the crime. So that actually was a progressive innovation at the time. The gentleman from UPI.
I didn't think of it that way, but okay.
Honor to Borgrop, Mr. Dimon. About 4 years ago, the chief security officer of one of the major houses in New York told us that there'd been up to 1 million attempted intrusions, cyber intrusions, in one day. How concerned are you about the cyber threat, cyber crime, and cyber terrorism?
We get hundreds of thousands a day. Okay, and we've got these major security centers, and we work with the governments around the world to protect ourselves. A lot of we read about today that they call denial of service. They're not getting into our computers. They're flooding the lines, and but it's out of Iran. Okay, a lot of it's coming out of Iran. They're flooding the lines so you can't get through. So it's not that they're not getting inside our computers. But something like JPMorgan spends a tremendous amount of time and effort in cybersecurity. We work closely with every government agency there is. We're in favor of those new cybersecurity laws, though we think they should be done in collaboration. You know, not like all these other laws are set up where, you know, you shall be cyber secure, and if you're not, we're going to come after you. We need their help. Remember, you know, the CIA, the NSA, the Department of Defense, they actually know what these attacks are at the border sometimes, and we don't. So business and government have to work together in this, protect the American public so we can stop cyber crime. But it's a big deal. It's going to get worse. Computers in 10 years are going to be 100,000 times faster. And so they'll be able to do calculations quicker and get through quicker. And we'll have to meet that in every way, shape, or form. And so believe me, banks, I think, are pretty good at this. We've been doing this a long time. And there are rules and regulations. But we have to really stay in front of it. And how many of you worry about it? The other thing to worry about, don't think of just the cybersecurity coming over the internet to you. Like everything we do authenticate you. We know more about some of that stuff than you think. But think of the person that joins your company from inside. That's where you're going to get it. And so,
thank you for that reassuring point. there's a young lady in the second to last row.
You can create internal firewalls too, is how you protect yourself from any one individual getting into all access to all systems and all that.
Hi, Danielle Douglas from the Washington Post. So many of the rules coming out of Dodd-Frank have yet to be written. So I'm curious, how much of an impact is the current regulatory environment having on your business?
So separate the business, okay? If you look at, I'm not going to talk this quarter because we release earnings on Friday, so think of prior this quarter. underlying business pretty good. Small business loans up, 12 straight months of 12 straight quarters, middle market loans up, market shares up in investment banking, trading's been okay, mortgage loans are up, mortgage problems are coming down. So actually pretty good. If you talk about, and I think you make a point, Dodd-Frank, I think 25% has been done. Okay, it's being fought in the courts now. Huge, I think, and it's really hard for me to calculate a number, but I'm gonna tell you it's gonna cost us overhead well over $1 billion a year at one point. And not just Dodd-Frank, Basel III, FSA, we get MiFID, MiFID, we get rules from Brussels. A lot of these are contradictory, overlapping. All I want at one point is we sit down and have a conversation about what do we really need for safety and soundness and all that, and what's creating unnecessary burden. And that burden is going to be higher and small the smaller you are, in my opinion. And I'm not in favor of that. I don't want to hurt community banks. They have a great role in life. So I just think you need collaboration to get it done. It's just not going to get done properly if we're just always fighting with each other. Like I said, the most important, capital and liquidity. And there are 398 other rules. But you should know we're trying to work with everyone, accommodate. We have no choice. I mean, we have to accommodate all the new rules, and we are going to do it. And we're going to do it in a way in the spirit and the letter of the law. That's what we're going to do. And that doesn't mean we won't comment on it, because regulators get very mad at me when I comment at all. We are going to comment, but we will meet the terms we're required to meet. And I think another conversation should be, forget JP Morgan. JP Morgan's going to be fine no matter what. I mean, just believe me. I'm not worried about JP Morgan. I am worried about the country. I mean, so we should do these things right for the future of the United States of America, not for JP Morgan.
Got time for one last one, Gary. Let me apologize in advance for the many people with their hands up. It's just demand exceeds supply, a well-known market problem.
Mr. Dimon, thanks. I'm Garrett Mitchell, and I write the Mitchell Report. And I want to ask you arguably a too-big-to-fail question, but this is not about J.P. Morgan Chase or Barclays. It's about the U.S. and China. China is on the brink of a major change in its leadership. It has written its own sort of prescription for new economic directions, which they know they have to initiate, or they too will fall off the cliff. We may or may not be looking at a major change in leadership in this country, but we are looking at the fiscal cliff. And I'm wondering, from your perspective as somebody who does business all around the world, and despite your protestations about not really knowing much about politics, how you assess the relative chances of success for America dealing in the short term with its fiscal cliff and longer term with its ability to get some semblance of good governance, and with the Chinese to be able to do the same and make the changes in their economy so that the two largest economies and polities in the world will help things stay online.
So China has huge issues it's got to deal with, okay? And there are really two. They got to broaden out their democracy. And remember, our democracy started as, you know, white men over a certain age who own property. They got the 90 million people in the Communist Party vote. They got to broaden it out. Every society has created a middle class, created some form of democracy over time. And it's hard. And they're worried about losing control and social unrest, et cetera. They've got to broaden out their economy. And when you look at the economy, think of the financial system as kind of the spin wheel. So it's not the most important thing in an economy, but it is where people, investors of all type, pension funds, insurance, individuals meet through vehicles of all type to invest in projects and companies and startups and venture and R&D. And they can't macro-manage down the road. So they've got two huge things to go through. We, as the United States, should help them do that. It's in our interest that they grow peacefully, they can take care of their 1.3 billion people, et cetera. There are going to be complaints, but I would defend, you know, this Hank Paulson had that strategic economic dialogue. We have to do that. It's the right thing to do. America will have America's might, in my opinion, is based upon three things. It's economic power, which is the foundation of all other things and all jobs and all buildings and all, you know, I know when I see some of these people standing in front of the Hoover Dam, you know, the government, no, that was actually built by Bechtel. It was your taxpayer money The know-how came out of usually comes out of American business, including, I checked, who built the spaceships and land.